This week at Interior. Secretary Jewell in Seattle this week, the 51st and final city to join Let's Move Outside. That's the national movement to inspire the next generation of youth to play, learn, serve, and work on public lands. Let's Move Outside is funded by a $2.5 million grant from American Express. That will provide 2 years of funding for the YMCA of Seattle to get more young people outdoors, from local parks to federal lands and waters. During her Seattle visit, the secretary joined about 150 local youth to participate in a service project, weeding and mulching at Seward Park, which contains one of the last surviving tracts of old-growth forest within the city of Seattle. Secretary Jewell, Deputy Secretary Connor, and senior Obama administration officials will crisscross the country next week to help the National Park Service mark its 100th birthday on Thursday. From New York City to Little Rock, Arkansas, from the Cesar Chavez National Monument, on to Glacier, Yellowstone, and the Mississippi River, the Secretary will highlight the Park Service's value in preserving our cultural heritage, protecting our national treasures, and providing an economic engine for local communities. To find a Centennial event near you, check out nps.gov. The USGS this week awarded approximately $3.7 million to six universities to help move the ShakeAlert earthquake early warning system from the development stage to the production stage. USGS has also purchased more than $1.5 million in new sensor equipment to expand and improve ShakeAlert. An earthquake early warning system can give people a precious few seconds to stop what they're doing and take protective actions before the severe shaking waves from an earthquake arrive. Check out the whole story at usgs.gov. The National Park Service this week started taking applications for $8 million in grants to preserve and highlight the sites and stories of the African American struggle for equality in the 20th century. Park Service Director Jonathan Jarvis says the aim is to educate and inspire a new, diverse generation of citizens as the nation continues its march to a more perfect union. Read more about the grants at nps.gov. Interior this week announced a proposal to rewrite regulations that govern how coal companies guarantee they'll restore land once the coal is gone. Specifically, that could mean more stringent rules to stop companies with shaky financial histories from so-called self-bonding or making promises not backed by cash, stocks, or other collateral. See more at doi.gov. A major step forward in wind energy development on opposite coasts this week. The Bureau of Ocean Energy Management announced it will consider issuing a non-competitive lease to Trident Winds, which wants to build 100 floating wind turbines off the California coast, each one capable of generating 7 to 8 megawatts of energy. The California project comes in addition to more than 120,000 acres off the coast of North Carolina being proposed for commercial wind energy leasing and development there. The Kitty Hawk Wind Energy Area joins 11 other East Coast areas already leased to wind energy developers offshore Virginia, Maryland, New Jersey, New York, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts. It's all part of the president's climate action plan to create American jobs, develop domestic clean energy sources, and cut carbon pollution. And the highest mountain peak east of the Rocky Mountains has a new name. The U.S. Board of Geographic Names voted unanimously to rename South Dakota's Harney Peak Black Elk Peak after a revered Oglala Lakota holy man. The new name is now considered official for use in federal maps and publications. That's this week at Interior.